IVM.
Hi, I'm Satyajit.
Hi, I'm Rachita.
Welcome to Paperback by the Open Library Project.
We have as our guest today Devanshi Jain. Devanshi is the co-founder of The Curious Reader. In the first half of the episode, we discuss Devanshi's life as a digital nomad, her law degree, and how the personal MBA has been her Bible as an entrepreneur.
In the second half, we discuss The 4-Hour Workweek by Tim Ferris, The $100 Startup by Chris Guillebeau, Outliers by Malcolm Gladwell, and Rethinking History by Keith Jennings. Happy listening.
Fear comes in many forms, and we usually don't call it by its four-letter name. Fear itself is quite fear-inducing. Most intelligent people in the world dress it up as something else, optimistic denial. Most who avoid quitting their jobs entertain the thought that their costs will improve with time or increases in income. This seems valid and is a tempting hallucination when a job is boring or uninspiring instead of pure hell. Pure hell forces action, but anything less can be endured with enough clever rationalization. Do you really think it will improve, or is it wishful thinking and an excuse for inaction? If you were confident in improvement, would you really be questioning things so? Generally not. This is fear of the unknown disguised as optimism. Are you better off than you were 1 year ago, 1 month ago, or 1 week ago? If not, things will not improve by themselves. If you're kidding yourself, it is important to stop and plan for a jump. Barring any James Dean ending, your life is going to be long. 9 to 5 for your working lifetime of 40 to 50 years is a long-ass time if the rescue doesn't come. Almost 500 months of solid work. How many do you have to go? It's probably time to cut your losses. If you're nervous about making the jump or simply putting it off out of fear of the unknown, here is your antidote. Write down your answers and keep in mind that thinking a lot will not prove as fruitful or as prolific as simply brain vomiting on the page. Write and do not edit. Aim for volume. Spend a few minutes on each answer. Define your nightmare, the absolute worst that could happen if you did what you're considering. What steps could you take to repair the damage or get things back on the upswing, even if temporarily? What are the outcomes or benefits, both temporary and permanent, of more probable scenarios? If you were fired from your job today, what would you do to get things under financial control? What are you putting off out of fear? What is it costing you, financially, emotionally, and physically, to postpone action? What are you waiting for? For all of the most important things, the timing always sucks. Waiting for a good time to quit your job? The stars will never align, and the traffic lights of life will never all be green at the same time. The universe doesn't conspire against you, but it doesn't go out of its way to line up all the pins either. Conditions are never perfect. Someday is a disease that will take your dreams to the grave with you. Pro and cons lists are just as bad. If it's important to you and you want to do it eventually, just do it and correct course along the way.
Thank you, Devanshi Jain. That was an extract from the book The 4-Hour Workweek by Tim Ferriss. We'll be right back after this to discuss the book in further detail. Welcome to Paperback by the Open Library Project. I am your co-host Satyajit, otherwise known as Onion Knight in most food circles. I'm hosting this podcast with my co-founder at the Open Library Project, Rachita Sharma.
Hi guys, my name is Rachita. I'm an ex-banker, social impact entrepreneur, podcaster, writer, publisher, and inveterate learner. The Open Library Project is a curated library service which is offered to corporates on a subscription basis, where we set up a library at your space according to your company's learning requirements. The idea here is to create value, build a knowledge community, and encourage a growth mindset amongst our members.
Today we have with us on the show Devanshi Jain. Devanshi is the co-founder of TheCuriousReader.in. Devanshi has been reading since she can remember. What started off as an obsession with Enid Blyton slowly morphed into a love for mystery and fantasy. Even her choice of career as a lawyer was heavily influenced by the works of Earl Stanley Gardner and John Grisham. After quitting law and while backpacking around India, she read books on entrepreneurship, taught herself web design, and delved into social media marketing. She doesn't go anywhere without a book. Welcome to the show, Devanshi.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you for coming and bringing all your books along. It's great to, you know, just meet so many people who've done the same thing that I have. And yeah. I just feel more and more confident that, you know, I have company.
Yeah, I know
in this
mean.
Journey. Yeah. So, you know, tell us a little bit about yourself and what made you really take that switch and about the curious reader?
Okay, so the switch is actually really interesting. I did law and then I worked for 2 years.
Mm-hmm. Right.
At which point of time I realized that I don't like waking up in the morning and starting my day.
Soulmate.
Yeah. And so I left. Initially, it was meant to be a 6-month sabbatical because okay. I have never spent time at home. I've been in boarding school since I was 9 and then okay. college.
Okay.
So the idea was to spend a little bit of time at home. And I just ended up, somehow the stars all aligned and I just ended up quitting law.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
And then I didn't know what to do.
Right.
Right. So once, and then I got injured. So I ended up having to be on bed rest effectively for 2 months.
Okay.
And I was depressed. I didn't know what to do with myself. I was not used to doing nothing.
Yeah.
And then you got to know who your true friends are.
Yeah.
That books. Yeah.
No, and then I Googled following your dreams mm-hmm. randomly. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And that's how I found the 4-hour work week. And that's when I also discovered the author of the other book that I was going to talk about, that I'm going to be talking about, which is Chris Guillebeau.
Okay.
When I came across him, he was following his dream of visiting every country in the world before he turned 35.
Wow. Okay.
Okay. And and I really wanted to travel. It's been a dream of mine to travel. And I just decided that let's see, maybe I'm not going to do law. I don't know. But I'm first going to spend some time traveling.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So I started backpacking. I did a solo backpacking trip in India. Mm-hmm. The idea was to do it on a really tiny budget. So I did it on 500 rupees a day.
Wow. Excellent.
Oh, wow. Yeah. So it was quite challenging. And again, 4-hour work week really helped with that because he talks about how he also made this leap. He didn't have money. I didn't have the money.
Mm-hmm. Right.
I had, I think, about 10 or 15,000 rupees in the bank. And I just said, I'm just going to go do it because I didn't want to wait.
Yeah.
For a time when everything would be perfect and I would be able to do it.
Yeah.
So I went, I did. And along the way, I started doing a lot of random stuff. So I did copywriting. Mm-hmm. I worked with some travel company. In the middle, I moved to Vietnam on a whim and started working there.
Awesome. Then, were you teaching English in Vietnam?
No, I was working with a tech company.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah. Okay.
On the side, I was reading books. I was teaching myself web design. I was teaching myself social media marketing. My idea was to not go back to college.
Yeah.
Okay, I didn't want to spend my parents' money on going back to college because they were not very happy initially with
the decision of leaving law, obviously.
So my idea was that whatever it is, I have to do it on my own.
Right.
So obviously, I turned to books.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Right. Mm-hmm. And the 4-hour work week made me understand the value of creating a space for myself.
Mm.
That is... He doesn't believe in the concept of going to college and getting a degree and all that. And even though I have an excellent degree, which I don't regret doing at all, I didn't see a point in going back, getting another one, just to be back in a space where I was when I quit law.
Right. Yeah.
Because what I realized, my problem was not the law. My problem was the 9-to-5 life.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Mm. I didn't want to wake up in the morning, go be a cog in somebody else's wheel.
Yeah. Right. Yeah.
So anyway, so along the way I did that, I also incidentally started a podcast production company of my own.
Oh, really?
Oh,
yeah.
Wow. Which, are you listening?
So in the sense that I was more like a freelancer. So I was helping people produce podcasts.
Okay.
And I took Tim Ferriss's concept of geo-arbitrage, which is that you earn in dollars and you spend in a currency which is devalued against the dollar. So I work largely with American clients.
Okay.
Great. Wow. Very nice.
Yeah. Amazing.
And when we go into the $100 startup, I started it for less than $100.
Okay.
And I was profitable in 2 days.
Oh, wow.
So I followed. So, you know, the books which I've read have literally been my mentors. They've given me that incentive to do more than I could.
Yeah. Amazing.
And then, of course, when the Curious Reader came up, for me, it was a no-brainer because... I mean, to get paid to read doesn't get better than that.
Yeah, it doesn't sound like, you know, a job at all.
It doesn't, because today I wake up every day happy to go to work.
Yeah.
I work, this is the hardest I've ever worked in my life.
Yeah, absolutely, I totally understand.
Absolutely the hardest. But I can't shut it off. Like even when I'm at a party, I'm talking about work.
Yeah.
Which I'm trying to cut down on because
it's very difficult to do that.
Yeah, but it's really difficult. I mean, it's like an obsession.
You're so into your own project. You're just looking for opportunities to take it to the next level all the time. Right?
And more than that, I think it's also about getting feedback, right?
Yeah.
Because
you
know you have a certain way of thinking about it, but that may not necessarily be the way it is perceived by those around you.
Right.
Yeah. And especially if you're a writer, then you want to do justice to what you're writing.
Exactly.
So you don't want to just be it to be just your perspective.
Exactly.
So, I understand what you mean.
So great. Tell us a little bit about the 4-hour work week. It's one of the best sellers for the since the last decade, I think. And personally, for me, when I read this book, what stood out was the 10,000-hour rule.
Mm.
Kind of because I had put in 10,000 hours into something and I played tabla while growing up. And literally, we've put in 10,000 hours into that to master the instrument and all. And so that was one thing that really stood out for me in the book, because I was like, okay, now do I have to put in 10,000 hours into anything that I want to become an expert into? Or in, like, say, for example, if it's entrepreneurship, do I need to put in 10,000 hours into entrepreneurship to become an entrepreneur? That's what really stood with me. And the way Tim talks about it, I just love the way that he puts everything in a clear perspective. You know, it's like, yes, these are the certain ways people are doing things, but you can also do things in these ways, right? And it's not at all conforming with anything these other people are doing. Yeah. You can do it in a completely new way, and that's completely individual to you, right?
I think Tim Ferriss's biggest strength is that he teaches you the rules and then he tells you, go ahead and break them.
Yeah.
Okay.
Because I do believe that there is no one-size-fits-all formula for most people, right? So for me, even though, I mean, he's laid out a blueprint for how you can have a 4-hour work week. For me, that was never the takeaway from this book.
Right. Yeah.
I don't want to work only 4 hours in a week. I don't know what I will do with
my life.
I'm happy to read a lot. I still, even today, despite how many hours I may work, I make it a point to set aside time for reading. But if all I'm doing with my life is reading, I have a feeling that after some time, I may get a little bored. Not of reading, but of life in general. Life without a purpose has really no meaning.
Anything that you're doing for a long span every day, you'd want to take a break from it. So even if it is reading, you'd want to do something which is like maybe just watch a mindless Netflix show to sort of rejuvenate.
And I think for me, the thing about even about the 10,000 hour rule, I think what Tim is also, when he explains it after that, I think he also says that what you really need to do is you need to understand the 80/20 rule, right? Which is that 20% of the effort you make gives you 80% of the results. So to give a simple example of language learning, pretty much most, I think about 1,000 or 2,000 words in any language are all you need to be 90% proficient in that language. But it's that remaining 10% which will take you the next 5 years. Why do you need to do it?
Right.
And I don't intend to be a native speaker in French. I want to go there. Yes, I want to be able to order my wine. I want to say I want to have wine instead of saying I want to have a bath. But I'm not going to be living there. I'm not going to be working there. So why do I need to spend the next 5 years learning it? So instead of spending 10,000 hours mastering it, why not spend 100 hours mastering the...
those things that will give you the most result.
Will give you 80% of what you need.
And to give you an example, so when I taught myself web design, I taught myself HTML, I taught myself CSS. I reached a point where I can create a website based off a template. So the Curious Reader website, for example, is I did it. So we took a template and we just, I did a little bit of coding to modify it, did a little bit of design, added that on. But if I want to take it to the next level where I can create my own version of Uber, I need to spend 10,000 hours learning to do it. But that is not my need. So why do it?
Right.
The idea is to be efficient and effective. Not to just not to know something for the sake of knowing it. So know enough to get what
to
you
understand
need.
The basics.
Exactly.
But you don't need to be like the expert.
The basics are very important.
Right.
I mean, everybody discounts the basics, and Indians. Education system does not focus on the basics enough. But once you get the basics right, moving on from there is not very difficult.
I think as entrepreneurs, what we do sometimes is start measuring our success with the number of people you've hired or the number of hours you spend at work and be like, oh, now I'm giving in my 100% because I was sitting from 12 o'clock to 12. But maybe you're not, you know, actually being productive for more than even 2 hours. So when he talks about the 4-hour work week in terms of 4 hours of productivity, I would take that, you know. And you can spend another 4 doing whatever you need to, procrastinate maybe a little bit.
What he says also is that if you're if people around you know that you're only there for those 4 hours or whatever, they're hyper productive around you. And I've sort of seen this also in my own personal experience where, you know, I've told my office that I'm only here for maybe one day this week and I'm traveling for this. That day is hyper productive. I mean, they just come to me with everything and it gets done in a whole new way. So there is some, I think there's some merit to sort of limiting your access to your staff as well as everyone else, right? So just to increase the productivity.
No, and work expands to fill the time you have for it, right? Yeah. So if you, so I am really last minute person, okay? So I, because I realize that I'm most efficient when I'm last minute.
Okay.
So if you tell me to do something which will take, which should take me 3 hours, you tell me to do it 6 days before. If I start doing it 6 days before, it'll take me 6 days to do it.
Yeah.
If I start doing 3 hours before, I'll do it in 3 hours.
Right.
Right.
So, productivity is a function of need in that sense and of urgency.
Yeah.
And I've seen that also. So, at work, if I give a particular deadline and I say I don't care, it has to be done.
Yeah,
it is done.
It is done.
But if I, but the same work can take 2 days if I don't have that deadline.
In fact, it'll just be like, okay, you do it and get back to me. You most certainly will get it after 2 days. So
no, and that's where delegation also comes in, right? The minute you say something along the lines of someone do this, nobody does it.
Right.
You have to say XYZ. Please do this, and I want this done by then. So that's how. So all these things are, I mean, delegation, automation, understanding the value of time, which is something I think most people just don't get it.
Yeah.
Right.
Especially in India, we don't attach a value in terms of money to our time.
Yeah.
So I would, so we will spend 3 hours of our lives traveling from point A to point B to save 100 rupees when we could be making 500 rupees in that 300 in that in those 3 hours. So, you know, it's those small things which really change the way you think about life, the way you, the way you look at how you work, the way you look at how you function, which he teaches in the book. It, for a lot of people, it's a little hacky, right? A lot of people say, I mean, what is this nonsense? Why would you, this 4 hour work week? But you have to go beyond it and understand what he's really saying. And then again, you don't have to adapt everything into your life.
Right.
You adapt what works for you. What you think is useful for you.
In fact, we've spoken about the 4 hour work week earlier, but this is a very new take on the book and, you know, just picking up the right things and the relevant things and not just being like, okay, now I'll work 4 hours every day and my life will be sorted, because that's what Tim Ferriss
said. See, he does provide a little bit of a blueprint where he says, if you want to set up your life, do it this way. But again, just because it works for him doesn't mean it'll work for me, because we all function differently.
Absolutely.
Definitely.
So I am a real night owl. I am happiest working till 2, 3 in the morning. Ask me to work at 7 in the morning, my brain will not function.
Right.
So if Robin Sharma tells me wake up at 5 a.m. and start working, it's pointless, because I'm not productive from 5 to 9. My brain just doesn't function.
I get that.
So for me to follow that,
I've actually read a study that it's harmful to, you know, get people who are not morning people to wake up in the morning. I hope there's some relevance.
Please send it to me. I'll send it to my mother.
This is just Facebook validating your own thoughts back to you.
Yeah, great.
Great. So yeah, that's I think very interesting take on the 4 hour work week. I think very useful book. Who would you suggest this to?
I would suggest it to anybody who thinks there's something missing in their life.
Okay.
Okay. I know a lot of people who are stuck, who don't like their life. But they don't know how to escape it. So if you look at the tagline, it is escape the 9 to 5. Right? And they don't know how to escape the 9 to 5 because that's how they've been taught all their lives. And I think it also comes with a caveat, which is that I'm very fortunate that today I don't have, like, you know, I'm not sending money back home to my parents, for example. I don't have that responsibility to another. Today is just me. I do take care of my parents and I do all that, but I don't have a fiscal responsibility to somebody else. So I can actually chart my own life, and I have very supportive family.
Right.
So in that sense, I'm lucky. So I understand somebody who's, you know, born down in debt or who's struggling with all that, finding it difficult. But if you really work around it and you can actually do something, start something on the side.
But in fact, your partner, Nirbhay, has you know, he is doing the Curious Reader alongside his existing job. So maybe, you know, that could be an option for people who have responsibilities.
Exactly.
Where you're giving a certain amount of time to your passion and you're still being sustainable during the course.
And I think that's what people need to realize, that there is a way to do it. Mm. But I think most people just, honestly, I think they just don't bother. So, you know, I got a lot of, oh, you're so lucky. So you get to travel, you travel so much. Oh, you're so lucky. You worked in Vietnam, and while you were working, so my work in Vietnam was, I was a digital nomad. So I would spend my time traveling around. I would work in Vietnam. Cool, yeah. I would work here. I went and lived in McLeodgunj for a month.
Amazing. Oh, nice.
Yeah. Amazing. So I did whatever. So his logic was, you work as in you work.
Yeah. Where you
work,
you are,
that's, I don't care. Yeah.
Right. Yeah.
So they said, oh, you're so lucky. You do all this. You still, and you still get paid. Blah, blah. But
how is it lucky? It's like you decided to make those decisions.
No, and see, the thing is, nobody sees all the drama which went on behind the scenes,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
Nobody sees the resilience. Nobody sees the fact that people look at, even today, okay, it's been 10 years since I quit law.
Mm.
And even today, people look at me and say, are you going to go back to law? I said, you know, I spent more time not doing law than I did doing law.
Yeah.
Oh, why don't you go back to law? You would have made so much money. Because money is not the be all and end all of life, unfortunately.
Yeah. Mm. Mm.
For me, at least, it's not.
Yeah.
It's a way. It's a means to an end, not an end.
Yeah, that's totally true. I totally agree
with
you.
Yeah, you get that.
Yeah.
So, like, you chase fulfillment instead of, you chase meaning instead of just monetary pursuits.
I think our first, at least my first job taught me that I definitely don't want to do banking.
Yeah.
That was the contribution from it. So,
yeah. And I think a lot of times you do that trial and testing. So if you look at, so I never apply for a job which requires me to send a CV, because if you see my CV, it's really checkered.
Hmm.
I've done all kinds of things. Hmm. I worked with this think tank as social, to do, for somebody who doesn't do social media, I worked as a social media manager for a think tank.
Yeah.
I worked as a project manager for a tech, for an American tech company in Vietnam, a job which I have no idea how to do.
Hmm.
I've done freelance web designing. I've done blog consulting. I've done podcast production. I've done everything.
But that's great, right? It just teaches us that you don't need the expertise in that. Like you said, right? The 80-20, even if you have 80% knowledge that you've probably given yourself, is enough to actually pursue that career.
And you need that relative expertise, which is another concept which he talks about, that you need to be just more bigger expert than somebody else.
Right.
Yeah.
That's how you teach, right? So today I have to know. So to give you an example, the curiosity of neither of us has any background in journalism, nothing.
Mm.
So we've actually been putting in the hours. So if I count the number of hours I spent on the Curious Reader, I have probably spent about 10,000 hours.
Amazing.
Okay. Yeah. But I would still not count myself as an expert, because it's been doing a bunch of roles. It's been doing, you know, a little bit of graphic design here, a little bit of web design. But what the Curious Reader has done is it's given us a chance to explore journalism without doing the degree.
Yeah.
Right.
So nobody would have ever hired me as an editor, right? But here I do the editing.
But you're doing the edit anyway.
I'm doing the editing, and I can see the difference, the progression in terms of work.
I think that also benefits. So, you know, Satyajit and I have a similar background. Like, we've not done anything in
publishing as such.
Publishing earlier.
Exactly.
But I think that gives you that perspective of, you know, there's no box for you, right?
Yeah.
So there's no limitation.
It's sort of like you're not bound by the constraints of an existing institution, right?
And I also think there's no fear, because you don't even know what to fear, right, at that point, because you don't know much. Yeah. You're learning on
you
the way.
You learn along the way, and you learn by your mistakes, that's what you kind
and
of...
And you fail along the way, and you learn
You learn
from
the failure,
absolutely.
Right?
Yeah.
Great.
And of course, whenever you're stuck, you always have books to go back to.
Oh, yeah.
Absolutely.
On that note, we're going to take a short break, and we'll be right back after this.
Hi, everybody. Welcome to another awesome week on the IVM Podcast Network. If you're not following us on social media, please make sure you do. We're IVM Podcast on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. I also kind of wanted to make a couple of other announcements, right? So first, as I think I mentioned last week, I just want to kind of reiterate, we're going to be closing our SoundCloud channel at the end of this month. So if this is where you're hearing us, please maybe try and listen to us on something else, maybe the IVM Podcast app, maybe another app. We're on all kinds of different platforms. The other thing is a little happier, right? So for the first time ever in Asia, we have a podcasting award for shows made in Asia. And we're very happy to announce that a number of our shows have been nominated. Pesa Vesa, Tech Careers in the New, Vartala, Lab and Junior One have all been nominated for these awards. Please go to the website asianpodcastawards.com and go vote for our shows. Come on, make us win, guys. And let me tell you what's going on this week. On The Seen and the Unseen, Amit is joined by China expert Manoj Kewalramani. They talk about the China-India relationship and conflicts that need to be resolved. On Varta Lab, Akash and Naveen are joined by writer, director and producer Raj Kaushal. Raj is an old friend of mine and he talks to these guys about Jim Jam, biscuits, Kiss Me Dogs and cricket. Speaking of cricket on What a Player, Mikhail and Siddharth talk about the India-South Africa Test Series. They also discuss the Japanese Formula One and announce the What a Player of the Week and Not a Player of the Week, also known as the Wow Now. Let's talk about what's happening in the pop culture side of things. On the Geek Fruit podcast, hosts Dinkar and Tejas are joined by their friends Kunal Rao from the East India Company. Join them as they discuss their favorite sitcoms of all time. On Mr. and Mrs. Binge Watch, Janice and Anirudh continue the saga of Indian shows that they love. Tune into the second part where they discuss the TV shows Family Man and Ye Meri Family. On Football Shootball, hosts Gaurav, Karthik and Shiva talk about the biggest rivalry in English football and how it's become more of a walkover than a competition. On Paperback, Satyajit and Rachita are joined by Natasha Malpani Oswal, the host of another IVM show, Boundless. She discusses her love for writing along with the creative process she practices every day. On Keeping It Queer, Naveen and Farad are joined by our producer Madhuri Advani to understand asexuality and bust the myths surrounding this umbrella category. With that, let's get you onto your show.
Welcome back, guys. We still have with us Devanshi Jain of the CuriousReader.in. Hi, Devanshi.
Hi.
It was a very interesting conversation in the first half, and yeah. I think it's going to continue into the themes are going to continue into the books
exciting.
That we discuss.
Yeah.
So the next book we are discussing is The $100 Startup by Chris Guillebeau. Did I get that right? Guillebeau. Right. So tell us a little bit about this book. How did you pick it up?
So I actually started following Chris when he was doing his little round the world journey.
Right.
He had this dream of visiting every country in the world before he turned 35.
Right.
And that started off like this stream of books.
Hmm.
And one of them was this book called The $100 Startup, which the premise of which is that unlike popular belief, you don't need $1 million. You don't even need $1,000 to build a company.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You can start with 100.
Hmm.
And $100 in India is 6,000 rupees. And think about it. If you're starting a company for 7,000 rupees, chances of you being profitable sooner are much higher.
Yeah.
So when I followed what he talks of, which is a lot of you create value,
mm-hmm.
right? So what you have to do is find a gap in the market
mm-hmm. right.
and create a certain value for people and get them to pay you for it.
Right.
Yeah.
And all you need to do to start up is you need to put up a website, which today is not easy. I mean, you don't need to know how to code. You just go to WordPress.
Go to Shopify, go to Wix.
Go to WordPress, go to Shopify, go to Wix. Exactly. I mean, today anybody can start their own store. He says,
e-commerce
make an
store,
offer.
Right? Yeah, yeah.
Make an
yeah.
offer. Start selling something.
Hmm.
And because you can do anything online, you're not locally limited. You're not geographically limited.
Right.
So it's not like, so I can be sitting in India.
Hmm.
And work with somebody sitting in Timbuktu.
Right. Yeah.
Right. And because of PayPal, they can pay me.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So when I did my podcasting, I used to work with largely American clients mm-hmm. and they used to pay me via PayPal.
Amazing.
Okay.
And because I'm a night owl, it really worked because our timings
matched.
Aligned.
Wow.
Right.
Right. So I would be having meetings at 12 in the morning, 1 in the morning. We would be sitting. Otherwise, we would just communicate over email. Skype was there.
Yeah.
And this was 4-5 years back. Since then, tools are so much better now.
Oh, yeah. Right.
But I think the main takeaway is that don't get caught up in this thinking that I have to set up a factory. I have to set up like this big establishment where I need to hire 5 people. You don't.
Yeah.
If you combine the lessons from him and the 4-hour work week, today you can hire somebody to do certain things for you. You don't have to, you have freelancers, you have Upwork, you have Fiverr.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You can get somebody to do something for you for $5.
Oh, yeah. Fiverr's, we use Fiverr, in fact.
Yeah, exactly.
And it's the quality of stuff that comes out from there, if you choose the right person, is
It's a little bit of a trial and error.
Sure.
But
I've found that the recommended people on Fiverr are very well recommended. Like, the
exactly.
work speaks for itself. Yeah.
Exactly. So we also did that. When we were just starting up, instead of hiring, we got interns. And we are very particular, we pay.
Right.
So we got interns who were literature students, and we also paid them. We paid them a stipend, but we paid them something. So we got our work done. They got a little bit of experience. It worked for both parties.
Absolutely,
right.
And the idea is also that you be lean.
Hmm.
You try to do as much as you can on your own. What you can't, you outsource.
Yeah.
And think, make an offer as quickly as you can.
Right.
And what is interesting is he actually talks about, I mean, most of his case studies are American, yes. And of course, the American ecosystem is very different.
Yeah.
Also, keep in mind, this book is 7-8 years back. And I think India has a similar ecosystem now. Like, if you go to any co-working space, you see people, I mean, there's so much energy. I love co-working spaces. Okay, I come out of there like all happy and, and energetic and just feeding off all their energy. And he's actually given the example of this guy from India. Okay, called Purna Dugirala.
Okay.
Who started off this organization called Chandu. And initially started off as a personal blog. And then he started giving tips and tricks on Excel.
Okay.
And now he runs a academy, like this online Excel academy.
Okay.
Wow. And at the time of writing of this book, he was making $150,000 a year.
Oh, wow.
On track for 200,000. So, six, seven years back.
That's amazing. And he just teaches people how to use Excel.
Yeah, he has online courses. He has a website, a blog. And in preparation for this podcast, I went and looked him up to see if he's still around. And he's still around. He's living in New Zealand now.
Oh, wow.
But he's still around. Like, he's still doing it. He's still charging. So, if you guys want to learn Excel, go to his website.
Great.
And
amazing, like, and it just goes to show you, right?
Yeah, and all he did was he set up a website. And he just started, he started giving out free tips.
Yeah.
And then more and more people got involved, and then he just...
And then he had enough tips that people wanted to pay for.
He has half a million visitors.
Wow, yeah.
Wow, that's excellent.
Such
And Excel really is a problem, I guess.
Yeah, yeah. So, I have a real mental block.
So like you rightly said, you need to find where you can add value and then decide how much that value is worth and get people to pay you for it.
Yeah. I think it's, you know, how you're spending your $100 as opposed to just like... You know, being like, I have $100, so let me just finish it all. It's where you're using it that counts. So, and so I had this, you know, when I just newly became an entrepreneur, I had this fixation in my head of doing everything perfectly. Because when you are an employee, you're basically, and
that's
especially if you're leading a team, you're basically doing that, making sure that things are, you know, up to the mark. So... this was really difficult for me, and this was a struggle that I used to discuss with Satya a lot, that, you know, this is not looking as good, you know, do you think we should go on and put up this website? It's, you know, half as good. Yeah. It's not as amazing as it should be. But I think presence matters a lot more than it being like, you know, 100% perfect. Yeah. And just, I think it's an 80-20 in this also. But even if, you know.
And sometimes sometimes the quest for perfection works. The reason I learned HTML, CSS is because I wanted to create my own website.
Right.
I didn't like what I was getting. So I decided to learn to code so I can get it to the way I wanted it to be.
Yeah. Right.
Eventually, I did learn the lesson, which is that get it to 80%. It needs to be at 80% for you to launch.
If you
wait to get it to 100%, it is never going to happen. And I think it's one of the reasons why I never launched my travel blog, because I was so busy getting the details
right.
And I learned Illustrator to create my own logo. I learned HTML and CSS. I mean, it's just stupidity. I could have just started writing instead.
But it's a learning experience, right? Now you know better.
Now you choose what you want to spend time learning as well.
Exactly. So, and that's the thing. So the other part about the $100 startup is also that I didn't spend money, but I wasted a lot of time doing it. So just so don't limit yourself to $100 and waste time because you
because
want to
of that limit.
I mean, just go above it. It's I would say it's a prescription in the sense that it's just, they're just telling you that it can be done, but doesn't mean
have to do it within that limit, right?
Exactly.
Your $100 could be $1,000 or your $100, whatever works
for you.
But
the idea is that you don't need as much as you think you do.
You don't need those millions and billions of dollars to, you know.
Yeah, like start. I don't need an investor. Like today, we are actually, the Curious Reader is, and we are 6 people, which is a lot.
Yeah.
Okay.
Right? But if we really wanted to, we could have done it with 2 people.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
We could have. I mean, it would have involved. But the thing is, we wanted it to be a place with lots of different voices.
Right.
We wanted it to have a professional graphic design.
Yeah.
Otherwise, I know basic graphic design. I can sit and do it.
Yeah.
We can. Both of us could have written and done it.
Right.
But it depends on how you want to structure it.
Right.
Absolutely.
Right. Right.
But if you are stuck, start by spending 6,000-7,000 rupees. I mean, we think nothing today of spending it on a meal, to be honest.
Yeah.
Like a night out can run you 6,000-7,000 rupees easily.
Especially a party night out.
A movie today is $2,000. So spend that. It's a one-time cost. You can buy your domain name. You can buy your hosting.
Yeah.
All of that is for a year.
Yeah.
Spend some time writing.
Right.
Yeah.
Write about whatever you want. I mean, everybody has something to teach.
Yeah.
Right? And you can teach me.
If you start
creating,
that's when you are actually putting yourself
out
there.
Exactly. Create a body of work. Mm-hmm. Just start. And this is what we tell our people at on office also. Please create.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Just remember, everything you do is for you.
Right.
Right. Any article you write, of course, you're writing it for us.
Mm.
But your name is attached to it.
Yeah.
Oh, definitely.
So make sure it is the best thing you can do.
Mm. Right.
It is your responsibility. I can help you get there,
mm.
but I cannot give you that work ethic.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
So have you made your employees read the $100 startup?
No.
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 Okay. So the next book that we're going to be discussing is The Personal MBA by Josh Kaufman. So tell us a little bit about this book, Devanshi.
So the interesting thing about this book is that Josh Kaufman started off with his thesis that you don't need to go to business school
right.
to get a business education. All you need to do is read books.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Right. So he went and he read, I think, hundreds of books.
Mm. Okay.
And distilled all the information in those books to create into this one volume.
Amazing.
Okay.
And he says that instead of spending $150,000 going to business school, read my book. It'll give you everything you need to know.
Yeah.
And I actually agree with him. So I read this book and it taught me a lot of different principles.
Right.
It cost me $500.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
At the time. And I think it gave me a basic grounding in business school. Of course, like most work, I don't think theory matters as much as practice. I know that because when I started working, honestly, everything I did at work, I never learned in law school.
Because
I was in private equity and law school never taught me about foreign exchange management and creating shareholder agreements and all, nothing.
Yeah, absolutely.
I had to learn it at work. So I get where he's coming from.
Mm.
He's saying that instead of spending 2 years and $150,000 going into debt in business school, why don't you spend that time working? And if you need certain principles, you need certain things to... you need certain things to think about or you want a basic grounding in jargon, I have a book for you.
Amazing, right?
Read my book. Yeah. So when I read this book, I actually have copious notes. Like I took notes. It was like reading a textbook for me.
Yeah.
So I went back and I have like registers just full of notes where I just talked about, where I noted down everything.
Yeah.
So your important concept is sunk in cost, which is so important in a startup to know when to...
Stop.
To say that, you know, just because I spent 5,000 rupees doesn't mean I need to spend another 50,000 rupees
to
fixing
recover
it.
That. Yeah.
Exactly. Understand you've made a mistake. It's okay.
Yeah.
Let it go.
Right.
In terms of financial modeling, business modeling, understanding the concept that you don't need a business model.
Yeah.
And this is something even Chris Guillebeau says. You don't need a fancy 5-page or a 20-page business plan. Mm-hmm. You just need, your first thing is get started.
Yeah.
Start.
Yeah.
And that's where all of us get stuck. And I know I do more than anybody else.
Mm.
I really get stuck in this whole getting started.
Yeah.
But it's difficult. Yeah. It's not, it's not the easiest thing to do well. Like, because especially if you're starting up for the first time or you're a first time entrepreneur, you're faced with all these sudden new circumstances in your own personal life. Like everyone is now looking at you differently, maybe negatively, maybe initially, like, few years back, it was very negative to, like me, I'm a college dropout.
Mm-hmm.
And when I said, I'm starting a company, everyone told me, you're starting a company because no one's giving you a job. That's the reason you're doing it, right? And I was like, yeah, that is one of the reasons for sure. But it's not, it's perceived negative, was perceived much more negatively than it is today. Like today, it's still become like, oh, you're doing a startup, okay, best of luck.
And it's become cool now.
It's become cool
startup.
Now. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Also to be a dropout.
It's become cool to be a dropout.
Really?
Yeah,
that's
definitely.
That's good.
I felt it like
so
over
we
the last
have,
5 years.
I think in our office, I think two of them are college dropouts.
Okay. Mm.
And we don't hire on the basis of resume. We hire on the basis of passion and interview. So you give me a resume, I look at it and say, I don't know what to do with this.
Same here. Like,
exactly. I don't know how you judge somebody on a resume.
I've never seen the marks column actually where hiring someone because I was like, this
it has no relevance to what I'm hiring you for.
Exactly what Josh Kaufman is kind of saying.
Don't just because somebody is an MBA doesn't mean he knows what he's doing.
Oh,
right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right? And just because you read this book, you'll get a basic business business education, which will save you a lot of money.
Absolutely.
But until you really go out there and do stuff, and I think that's what all business books say, right? Yeah. Go out there and do stuff. I
mean, and get, figure it out.
Just start.
Yeah, just start. If you don't start, how are you going to learn? All the theory in the world cannot teach you. Yeah. I mean, we had all these brilliant ideas, and only to realize that one after another, they're being done by other people. No, yeah. and they all fell flat on their face. Mm-hmm. What we thought would really work
did not work at all.
Because it was all theory.
Sometimes, and mostly that happens to entrepreneurs, because you're so passionate about what you're doing, it's a great idea to you. But when you actually go and implement it, you realize it's not really solving any need for your consumers. And
exactly.
As impressed as you are.
Exactly.
So then you have to also let it go.
Yeah, to give you an example, okay, we did this one day, we did this random list of books with one word titles, okay, and even internally, like, what are we doing? I mean, what value are we adding books with one word titles on the most popular list on our website? We were all flabbergasted. Wow. We said, why?
Why is it popular?
Yeah, like, we didn't get it.
You don't know the consumption patterns of your audience also, right?
Yeah, you don't. I mean, there's only so much analytics can tell you.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. So,
I mean, virality is the example of, like, ridiculous things becoming popular, right?
Let's not go into social media and virality.
Great. And I think we are going to be running out of time. So the next book that we are going to discuss is Rethinking History by Keith Jenkins. So tell us a little bit about this book, Devanshi.
So this book has nothing to do with business and startups. The most interesting thing about this book, this was actually a prescribed text in college. It was part of my history textbook, and I can literally tell you this is the first time I think college blew my mind. Mainly because what this book says is that there's a difference between past and history.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Right. Past is what has happened, and history is a record of what has happened. And there is no one history.
Right.
Yeah.
Everything is filtered through the through the person who's recorded.
Right. Absolutely.
Absolutely.
Right. Yeah. So there is no objective truth. It's everything. I mean, today I choose what I want to record.
Right.
Right.
Today, I mean, even when you're editing, I decide as the editor, I decide what goes into an article and what doesn't.
Right.
So there is no objectivity. And for an 18-year-old to come across this concept that everything she had learned in school in history was basically because somebody decided I need to learn it.
Yeah.
It really changed the way I looked at things. It changed the way I read. It changed the way I became a lot more objective in the way I thought. It's also, I think, one of the reasons why I don't really read the newspaper. I prefer to read a blog because I'll read different perspectives about the same event.
Right.
To get a true understanding.
True understanding, because I do think that, you know, again, the media, they all have, everybody has corporate concerns. Oh, everybody. Yeah,
yeah. It's all biased to their own.
Everybody has, you all have political biases, right? Yeah. So I have a certain political bias.
Mm. Yeah.
And we try very hard not to, but today, if you tell me to publish something misogynistic, I can't do it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I just can't do it. Yeah. It's a personal bias.
Yeah. Yeah.
I know somebody else may think that way, but I just can't do it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So this whole idea of understanding the concept of objectivity and saying that everybody has their own truth.
Right.
Which you need to understand.
I mean, if we look at Instagram, for example,
whatever
we're documenting is what we want to document about our life, right?
Or Facebook,
but that doesn't define our life.
Yeah.
So, and that's the same with
history.
And
that's why Facebook is one of the leading causes of depression in the world, right? Because all you see on Facebook is, oh, I did this, I went there, I checked into first class lounge. This is all the good things which are happening in your life.
Yeah. Yeah.
But nobody knows about the inside. So nobody knows that, you know, maybe you are stuck in a bad marriage. That maybe all those really nice photos and it creates this false narrative of you for the world.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah.
But again, it is filtered through your own. You are choosing what you're showing to the world.
Right.
And even in objective subjects like history, what you consider objective, it is a historian who's showing you they think you should know.
Usually the winner has written the history. The winner of the war has written the history.
Yeah, so it's, you know,
filtered according to...
Ties in very well with 1984 in a lot of ways, right?
Totally living through 1984 Orwellian times right now.
You're continuously rewriting history. And
absolutely.
I recently read this really interesting article in New York Times on 1984 and how they're like all these different versions... Most of them coming out of India of 1984, which are now available on Amazon.
Okay.
And a lot of them, they've rewritten parts.
Oh,
yeah.
Is it? I wasn't aware of this.
Yeah, they've read it in parts. It's very, I'll send it to you. It's a very, it's an interesting article. Most of them, it's not just India, but it's coming out. But they mentioned a couple of Indian publishers.
Okay.
Who are doing it. Like, you know, small indie publishers, nobody mainstream.
Right.
But yeah, so it's, we are also now, we are rewriting history. Yeah. So when I was...
You know, since you spoke about Indian authors and since you all promote Indian authors so much, like, you know, how Amish... explain the Shiva trilogy, or if you think of Devdutt Patnaik, who's details. You know, totally reclaiming implied mythology. Mythology. So it just that is, I think, more attractive to people now because you're getting another perspective,
exactly,
as opposed to one thing that was taught to us and, like, you know, ingrained into us, and then,
like, we took what we learned in school as fact.
But
like you rightly said, it's not fact, it's just the recorded version of the person who wrote that.
And if you think about it, most of history has been recorded by privileged men.
Right.
And they've totally, women don't feature in a lot of history, except unless you're Marie Antoinette and then you're featured as a villain.
Those few, you know,
so we did subaltern history in college. So we did what the role of the Adivasis in independence.
Okay.
And there was one, but where is it in our history textbooks?
Nowhere. Yeah, nowhere.
Where is the role of women who are not Sarojini Naidu and Vijay Lakshmi Pandit?
Right.
Where is the role of Kasturba Gandhi in our history, for example? So, and today, and that's where it's interesting today, because now people are reclaiming these narratives, right?
Absolutely.
And this is what you rightly said with mythology, especially you have retellings which are giving you the Ramayana from the point of view of Sita, or the Mahabharata from the point of view of Draupadi.
Right.
And these are important narratives, because we get them from the point of view of the men. But nobody talks about how Draupadi felt when her husbands, first of all, husbands,
she
decided she's a product who can be gambled away. But you talk about how Yudhishthir failed to see his property, which is his wife.
Right.
Being, I mean, he himself did the gambling.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
But you talk about his emotion, talk about women as property, but what about Draupadi?
Right.
Absolutely. Right. And that's where it all started, right? All the inequality and objectifying women. But I don't know, then it also comes down to a lot of religious institutions then sort of, you know, trying to control your narrative when you really want to talk about the truth.
Yeah.
So it's.
But it's very similar to we spoke about Virginia Woolf's Room of One's Own recently, and it's a nonfiction book that she's written, narrated, and she talks about how things are so patriarchal, and it's very similar to what we're talking about in terms of history, because. Even when we spoke about this on an earlier episode, it's like we've come a long way now. If you look back 100 years, to look to today's time, I think we've made a lot of progress. And I just feel the times we are living through is we've never been so connected as a species. We've never been able to see, like, I can now look at how people function in America maybe or in Japan and be like, oh, hey, they're doing things like that. So why aren't we doing things like this over here?
Exactly.
And information is so instantaneously spread across the world that... it's amazing. Like, information access is amazing. And that kind of lets us recalibrate our lives in terms of, I mean, this is the, I guess, where we are comparing our lives. Yeah. But it's just to sort of get a understanding of what is happening in the rest of the world, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah, this is the best time to learn from others.
Oh, definitely. Right. Yeah. I just feel like we're privileged to live in these amazing times. Like, I feel a real gratitude because I love to learn. I love to read. Yeah. And... you know, when I dropped out of college, the internet wasn't what it was today. When I dropped out of college in 2004. So that time there was nothing on the internet. Like, there was no videos on YouTube. There was no blogs. There was no nothing, right? And today when I want to learn something or research anything, it's just so easily available. Yeah. And that helps so much in being a startup founder or like running your own companies where you're not dependent anymore on set processes or, you know, that's why books are amazing and books by these amazing people who give you these amazing perspectives, which are completely different from the traditional perspectives. Yeah. So, sorry, went on a rant. great. So, Devanshi, tell us, you're, of course, not on social media, but where can we find Curious Reader on social media?
So, the Curious Reader is there on Facebook, Twitter and Instagram. And, of course, we have a lovely website called thecuriousreader.in where you can read everything. You can just read about books. You can find book recommendations. You can meet like-minded people. Awesome. To discuss. We've recently started a book club on Facebook.
Oh, nice.
So do join that, and we'll be sharing information about books. We'll be discussing books, everything a book club does, and it's online, so it doesn't matter where in the world you are.
That's fantastic.
You can come in.
That's great to hear. So thank you so much for being on the show today.
Thank you so much.
It was a pleasure having you.
Thank you.
And we hope to have you again as a guest.
Thank you so much.
And a big thank you to all our listeners. You can follow the Open Library Project on LinkedIn, Instagram, and Facebook for latest updates on our events. And stay tuned for the next Paperback podcast on IVM Podcasts. Happy reading. You can follow IVM Podcasts on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter at IVM Podcasts. Listen to Paperback on the IVM Podcast app, website, or wherever you listen to podcasts.
Are you looking for India's most awesome cricket podcast? Are you now tired of listening to the same old guys drone on about cricket everywhere? Edges and Sledges is a weekly cricket podcast hosted by three fans of the game, Varun, DJ, and myself, Ashwin. It was established in early 2018, has over 60 episodes now, and is of course now proud to be on the IVM Podcast Network. Each week, we get together from three different time zones, the USA, the UK, and Singapore, and we talk about things from the world of cricket, with a focus on Indian cricket. We often interview special guests from all around the world, including former cricketers and cricket media personalities. So check out Edges and Sledges, the cricket podcast, now on the IVM Network.
Look, up in the internet, it's a meme. No, it's a cat video. No, it's the Geek Fruit Podcast.
That's right. We interrupt this riveting broadcast to tell you about our show, The Geek Fruit Podcast, where Tejas, Dinkar and I, Jishnu, talk about everything in pop culture, including DC, Marvel, Star Wars, Netflix and everything in between.
You know how your friends hate it when you ramble about some nerdy crap and you just want somebody to listen to you? Well, sorry, there's nothing we can do about that, but come listen to us ramble and it'll almost be like the real thing. Kind of.
Listen to new episodes of The Geek Fruit Podcast every Monday and The Geek Fruit Bulletin every Thursday on iTunes, Google Podcasts, the IVM app, or wherever you listen to podcasts. Happy listening, you nerds.